ila alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Allahumma la sahla illa ma ja'altahu sahla wa anta taj'alul hazna idha shi'ta sahla. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wa hlul 'uqdatan min lisani yafqahu qawli. Allahumma faqihna fi din wa 'allimna at-ta'wil wa aftah lana futuhal 'arifin. Amin. Allahumma lakal hamdu wa ilayka al-mushtaka wa anta al-musta'an wa 'alayka al-balagh wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi al-'ali al-'azim. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Jazakumullah khair for joining us this week once again for our class on the Treatise of the Seekers or Risalatul Mustarshideen by the great scholar Al-Harith Al-Muhasibi alayhi rahmatullah. So we reached the section that speaks about the intention, and it's probably one of the most important segments in the book, and the reason why that is self-evident, because a person's actions is reliant completely on the intention behind it. You can have two people or more doing the exact same action and doing the exact same deed, but the only determining issue which hinges or which is hinged upon the acceptability is dependent all on the intention. So you can find two people praying the exact same prayer. One gets a reward and the other person doesn't, or one gets a significantly bigger amount of reward or greater amount of reward than the other person, although they did the exact same action. And that's simply because of the intention behind the action. One person's intention was more superior than the other, or one's intention was existent whereas the other person's wasn't. So you can already imagine how important the subject of the intention is. In fact, some of the early scholars of the religion, they would even go and say and make very elaborate statements. For example, you find Imam Ahmed, and he said, alayhi rahmatullah, that it's one third of the entire religion. So just the intention alone is considered to be one third of all of the religion. And that's not something far-fetched, because if you study Islamic jurisprudence, whenever you make the prayer, you need an intention. Whenever you make the ablution, or any type of purification, you need an intention. When you want to pray your salah, when you want to pay your zakah, there needs to be an intention. When you want to fast, there needs to be an intention. When you want to perform hajj, there needs to be an intention. So you can begin to imagine how many of these aspects in Islamic fiqh, which is daily practice, or one of the most, or some of the most important practices that we have in the religion, all hinges upon the existence of an intention behind the action that we do. So something which is very important. And that's why the author, he says, وَنَفَعَنَ اللَّهُ بِعُلُومِهِ فِي الدَّارَيْنِ, and may Allah enable us to benefit from his words. He says, فَفْحَسْ عَنِ النِّيَّةِ, which means search for an intention and look for an intention. Whenever you're doing an action, try and intend therewith to become closer to Allah. Even if it's something that you do habitually. So for example, something as maybe insignificant to you as drinking water, you might not associate that with a good action. But if you make an intention and you formulate an intention in which you kind of do it for the sake of Allah, then you get a reward for that. So that's why the author, he says, فَفْحَسْ عَنِ النِّيَّةِ, which means search for an intention. And this is the actions that many of the early Muslims used to have. So they would always attempt to have an intention for almost everything that they would do. So as an example, it was mentioned in the Hilya of Abi Nu'aym, he mentions, وَقَالَ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ بْنَ أَحْمَدِ بْنَ حَنْبَلُ. So this story is about the son of Imam Ahmed. So Imam Ahmed, you know, as one of the great imams of the religion, his son Abdullah ibn Ahmed, he had a question. He was speaking to his father and he had a question, and he said, قلت لي أبي يوم, and he goes, one day I said to my father, أوسني. So أوسني is like, give me an admonition, give me a piece of advice that would serve as an admonition for me. يا أبا, he said, oh my father. Then he said, فقال يا بني إنو الخير, he said, oh my son, always intend to do something good. فإنك لا تزال بخير ما نويت الخير, because for indeed you will always be in a state of good so long as you intend to do good. So long as your intention is always in the right place, you will always be in a good state. And this was mentioned and collected by Ibn al-Jawzi, in his book Manaqib al-Imam Ahmad, so a book that was written by the great Hanbali Imam and Hanbali scholar Ibn al-Jawzi, Al-Hafid Ibn al-Jawzi, on the al-Manaqib. Al-Manaqib is when the pearls and the great noble stories and virtues of Imam Ahmad. So he wrote a book about the virtues of Imam Ahmad, and this is collected, this story was mentioned therein. So you can imagine, you always be in a state of good if your intention's always in the right place. And that's the determining factor, because even if you don't end up doing the good thing anyway, you still get the reward for attempting. And that's really the thing that matters the most, because you may be in a difficult situation. You may not have the ability to always perform a good deed. You may not be able to do what you want to do. But because you had a good intention, and because you attempted and you wanted and you desired, then you get the reward for desiring, you get the reward for attempting, you get the reward for trying. And that in itself is considered to be a good action and a good deed. So really, this is something that a person shouldn't ever, this is something a person shouldn't ever have to think twice about. A person should always do it as much as they're able to do so. And it's not very difficult. Maintaining an intention, many scholars mentioned, can be a difficult feat, but to produce one, to formulate one, isn't really that difficult. So a person should attempt, at least, at the very least, even if you are in a difficult situation, even if you can't pay sadaqah, okay, at least make an intention to do so. Even if you are finding it difficult to perform the fasting, at least, or any, optional fasting, at least make an intention that you do want to do it. So inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will look into your heart, and then because of that intention, he will give you a reward for it. And maybe he will bless you to have the ability to do it, inshallah, one day. Ibrahim al-Nakhi'i mentioned, and he said, لَمْ يَكُنْ عَبْدِ الرَّحْمَنِ بِنْ يَزِيدَ النَّخِعِي. So he's talking, Ibrahim al-Nakhi'i is one of the great scholars, and he was one of the people who the Hanafi tradition goes back to in the way in which they acquired their Islamic jurisprudence. So he's one of the great scholars, and he was one of the forebearers of the Hanafi tradition, and he was one of the great scholars of the Muslim world. And he made a statement, and he said, "Lam yakun Abd al-Rahman ibn Yazid al-Nakhai." So he's speaking about one of the Tabi'een, and he said, "The great Tabi'i scholar Abd al-Rahman ibn Yazid al-Nakhai." He goes, لم يعمل أو لم يكن عبد الرحمن بن يزيد النخعي يعمل شيئا إلا بنية. He said, عبد الرحمن بن يزيد النخعي would never do any action unless he had an intention. So he would not do anything. And how much action is, comprises your daily life? You're literally doing something all the time. Okay, so today, in today's world, whether you are sitting down on your phone, or you are having something to eat, or you are reading a book, or you are traveling, or you whatever is the case, you are doing something. There is something that you are doing. Now imagine if you had a good intention for all of those things that you were doing. And imagine you did that for an entire lifetime. How much of a good deed did you accumulate without having done really anything? Because you already did was make an intention for something you probably would have done anyway. But because you formulated a good intention, as you were doing those things which would be, which would already have been in your schedule, or something you probably already would have done anyway, imagine getting a reward. It's just literally you getting a reward for free without you really doing anything. So these are really things that none of us should be squandering. It's such an easy thing to do if we put our mind to it and we make it into a habit. That's the thing that we need to do. And we have so many bad habits. Imagine if we start picking up on good habits, and that way, it would remove a lot of the bad things, that a lot of the bad habits that we already have. And it can also serve to be as a means of getting a reward with our Lord, imagine. So it's something which is very important for a person to do. And the great Hanafi scholar Abdul Fattah Abu Ghudda, he mentions, and he says, وَلِلسَّلَفِ فِي فَحْسِ النِّيَّةِ وَتَخْلِيصِهَا مِنَ الشَّوَائِبِ أَقْوَالٌ كَثِيرًا. He says, if you look back into the statements of the early Muslims, you would find that they have so much to say about this topic. So this topic is something that they have so much to say about. They mentioned, قال يوسف ابن أسباط, so one of the early scholars, he said, تخليص النية من فسادها أشد على العاملين من طول الاجتهاد. So he was somebody who was a scholar, a great mujtahid, Yusuf ibn Asbat, and he says that to formulate the intention and to remove and to clean and to purify the intention from that which would corrupt it is more difficult for a person who's intending and who wants to do a good action than embarking in huge issues of ijtihad. So he knows what he's talking about because he's a mujtahid himself. So mujtahid means somebody who exerts effort into trying to find the correct interpretation of either a verse in Quran or a hadith, prophetic tradition known as hadith, or anything else in the religion that's probably ambiguous. That's what a mujtahid does, and that's their job. So it's to come to an opinion onto an after having given that issue or case study a huge amount of time and consideration and effort. So he says that purifying the intention is much more difficult than trying to find the correct opinion on any case study or on any issue in Islamic jurisprudence. And that's something which is very interesting, because the job of a mujtahid is very difficult. It's not simple. The early Muslims amongst the Sahaba and the Tabi'een and the generations who came after, they would run away from these kind of issues. They would really wish for somebody else to take on that role. It's not like it is today where everybody wants to answer the questions and every single person wants to put their opinion forward, where every single person wants to be heard, every single person wants to, you know, showcase their opinion on every single issue. That level of narcissism didn't exist in those days. So everybody, if they had an opportunity to put it off for somebody else to take care of, they would happily do that. So doing ijtihad wasn't really a privilege. It only became something which was privileged later on, after many, many generations, and the Muslim world expanded, and people who do ijtihad were paid in order for them to become judges and people who would, influence societies, and people who were very powerful in their own right. Only then did it become something lucrative, or only then was it seen as something which was, there was an incentive at that time, because it became a government job. But in those days, in the early time, the days of the early Muslims, it wasn't something that anybody would have been interested in, because everybody would have known that this is plus people had more piety, and people didn't want to put themselves in a position in which their relationship with Allah would be compromised, because they would have to answer to Allah for giving an answer or attempting to find the correct opinion on an issue. For themselves, they would do that, but for others, or to put it, to give it as a fatwa, that would have been something that most people would be not be inclined towards. So he said, purifying the intention is even more difficult than that. It's more difficult than doing ijtihad, and ijtihad is something which is very difficult, because, in order to do ijtihad, just all you need to do is read a book called Al-Mustasfa fi Usul al-Fiqh by Imam al-Ghazali, alayhi rahmatullah. So he was one of the greatest Usuli scholars in the Islamic tradition, probably the greatest scholar of the Usul tradition. And he mentioned something quite interesting. He says, if you read his shurut and the conditions that he places for somebody to do ijtihad, he readily acknowledges in his Ihya that no one has the caliber of being a mujtahid mutlaq. In his time, mujtahid mutlaq meaning somebody who can unreservedly, without relying on anybody else, do ijtihad. So people who could be on the level of Imam Shafi'i, Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, Imam Ahmed, and Sufyan, Thawri, and Al-Layth ibn Sa'ad, and people on that level. That level will never ever appear again. And he was saying that in his time. So imagine the situation today. So he's saying that purifying the intention is even more difficult than doing ijtihad on a case study. A huge amount of ijtihad, he says. So he mentioned min tulil ijtihad, a huge amount of ijtihad. So something which is very, very interesting. And as Sufyan al-Thawri mentions, and he says, ما عالجت شيئا أشد علي من نيتي. لِأَنَّهَا تَنْقَلِبُ عَلَيْهِ. So he mentioned something very interesting, and he said, so this is Sufyan al-Thawri, the great scholar, he mentioned, I have never had to deal with an issue or try to remedy an issue that was more difficult than my own intention, because it keeps on turning against me. So I assume that I'm on the right track at one moment, and then all of a sudden I find myself indulged in something, and my intentions all over the place. And that's the difficulty, because to formulate it might be simple, because all you need to do is really consciously make that decision and say that you're doing it for whatever reason. But then along the way, that's where it becomes difficult, because maintaining that intention is so difficult. That's why many of the scholars, they say, you know what, just if you formulate the intention, that's good enough. Don't worry about anything that comes up, because they understand how difficult, especially in these times. So it really is something very difficult. The early scholars, for them, they mentioned it's difficult for them. So how do you assume the situation would be for people in the times that we're living in today? Then the author, he mentions, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, he quotes the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم when he said, إنما الأعمال بالنيات وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى. And this hadith is collected by Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim in their authentic collections, in which the Prophet said, indeed, every action is judged by its intentions. So every action is judged by its intentions, and every single person will retain that which they intended for. They will gain that which they intended. So you will be rewarded based on the intention that you have. So you would be rewarded solely, okay, primarily on the intention that you have. If your intention is good, then you will get the reward. If your intention isn't correct and it isn't good, then you won't get the reward, or you might even it might be a source of punishment even. So it's something we need to be extremely careful and very wary of, and something that we need to be very vigilant in regards to. The author, he says, وَلْزِمْ تَقْوَى اللَّهِ, always be fervent in appropriating and holding on to piety, having consciousness of Allah. Consciousness of Allah is something which is very, very important, because by being conscious of Allah, you are much in a much better stage and in a much better position to do something which is pleasing to Him. And you are in a much better position in avoiding that which is displeasing to Him. So a person should always hold on to and work hard regarding his, you know, being conscious of Allah. To be in that, to reach that state in of in itself is a journey. But the easiest way to do it, and this is something that many of the scholars have spoken about actually, if you read some of the early books on Islamic spirituality and taqwa and purification, they mention abandoning sins has a much better impact on developing God consciousness than just increasing the amount of good deeds that you do. So if it had to be doing more good deeds than you're already doing, or abandoning some of the bad things that you're doing, what takes precedence is abandoning the bad deeds that you're doing. That takes much more precedence over any, or over doing good deeds. And that brings a person into much more God conscious. Because really, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expects from you in terms of His obligations and recommendations aren't really that much. That which Allah has prescribed upon human beings isn't really too difficult for a person to do. A person could do it. What does Allah really ask for? وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ حُنَفَاءَ وَيُقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَيُؤْتُوا الزَّكَاةَ وَذَلِكَ دِينُ الْقَيِّمَةِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they were ordered not except to worship Allah sincerely. That's all that Allah really obliges a person to do. You know, sincerely worshipping Him. And you know, you pray your prayers, you do your zakat, you pay your zakat, and that's the entire religion. That's the comprehensive package of the religion. That's what Allah says in the Quran. It's not really that difficult for a person to do. You know, we make it difficult because of all the sins that we're carrying on our backs, but in actual reality, it's not really that difficult. But abandoning the sins, that's where the crux of the matter lies. So that's where the cream of the crop is. So that's where the benefit lies. Abandoning sins that we're doing, that's really where the reward lies. So that's really what a person should try and aim to be doing. So every single person will be rewarded in accordance with their intention. So if your intention is good, you'll get the reward thereof. If not, then it is what it is. So walzim taqwallah. Always try and hold on to and always try and make incumbent upon yourself being conscious of Allah. Be conscious in everything. In every single thing that you do, every single action that you do, what we should be doing is trying to come to that level or that consciousness of, is Allah happy with what I'm doing right now? Or is he not happy with this action? And then if it's something that he's happy with, or something that it's okay, meaning something that's merely permissible, then go ahead. And if it's something that isn't permissible, then you avoid it. And that's the best way, and that's the best way to be. If a person is in that state, then a person will have a much better relationship with their Lord. Then the author, he says, and he quotes the hadith, فَإِنَّ الْمُسْلِمَ مَنْ سَلِمَ الْمُسْلِمُونَ مِنْ لِسَانِهِ وَيَدِهِ وَالْمُؤْمِنَ مَنْ أَمِنَ النَّاسُ بَوَائِقَهِ. So this hadith, or this section here, which was narrated by Abu Hurairah رضي الله عنه, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, the Muslim is what the one in whom the other Muslims are safe from his or her tongue and their hand. So who's a true Muslim? So this is talking about an exemplary Muslim. So does it mean that the person who doesn't abide or who doesn't act upon this isn't a Muslim? But it just means that a person who doesn't act upon this isn't an exemplary Muslim. So Prophet ﷺ is speaking here about who is the exemplary Muslim. So he's saying the exemplary Muslim is the one whom the other Muslims, okay, feel safe from. They feel safe from his tongue or her tongue, and they feel safe from his hand or her hand. What does this mean? This means that in order for you to be a good Muslim, an exemplary Muslim, other Muslims should be safe from your verbal abuse and your physical abuse. If you are verbally abusing other Muslims, then you're not an exemplary Muslim. If you are physically abusing another Muslim, then you are not an exemplary Muslim. It doesn't matter how much you pray, and it doesn't matter how much good deeds that you do. If you are not acting upon this, it means that you're not really an exemplary Muslim. So we need to be exemplary Muslims. If we're not acting upon this, and if we're verbally abusing people, and we're physically abusing people, God forbid, it means that we're not exemplary Muslims. And then he says, alayhi salatu wasalam, وَالْمُؤْمِنَ مَنْ أَمِنَ النَّاسُ بَوَائِقَهُ. And the believer is the one in whom everybody is safe from their evil. It doesn't really matter what their religion is. If they're Muslim, non-Muslim, it doesn't really matter. A real believer is the one in whom mankind is safe from your evil. Okay. And the word bawa'iqa or al-bawa'iq is, or ba'iqa, means a shar, some evil, musiba, a tribulation, you know, harm. That's what it means. So if other people are not safe from your harm and your evil, it means that you are not an exemplary believer. You're not a true believer. That's what it means. So a person should try their best to remove any of these characteristics if they find it in themselves. Okay, that's our responsibility. Is that if we find that we have adopted or we habitually carry some of these characteristics, or we have some of these attributes embedded within us, then our responsibility is to try and remove it as much as possible. And then the author, he quotes the best of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, and he says, "Qala Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu." Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, he said, "Ittaqi Allah bi ta'atih wa ati'i Allah bi taqwah." It's very interesting. He says, have consciousness of Allah by obeying Him, and obey Him by having consciousness of Him. So it's really it's something which is simultaneous on both sides, meaning if you do one, you get the other as a reward. So if you have taqwa of Allah, if you have consciousness of Allah, how do you get that? By obeying Him. By, if you obey Allah, what do you get in return? Consciousness of Allah. Really, if you do something which is pleasing to Allah, you become more conscious of Him. And that's how you gain consciousness of Allah, by doing acts of obedience. And then he said, at the same time also, obey Allah by having consciousness of Him. Because in order for you to truly obey Him, you need to have some level of consciousness of Allah. So you do it, you do both, and one is a reward of the other. Okay, so something which is very interesting. And then he said, this is very important, وَكُفَّ يَدَكَ عَنْ دِمَاءِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ, and hold and restrain your hand and yourselves and your hand from the blood of Muslims. Meaning, do not ever engage in shedding blood. Okay, that's something that you should avoid. Then he says, وَبَطْنَكَ عَنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ, and safeguard your stomach from their wealth, from devouring their wealth. So meaning stealing and appropriating wealth that doesn't really belong to you, that is something in which if you were to do, that's a grave violation of this, of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's law. وَلِسَانَكَ عَنْ أَعْرَاضِهِمْ, and safeguard your tongue from their honor. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given honor to the believers. So your responsibility and our responsibility collectively is that we safeguard our tongue from speaking ill of other people, especially when it's not our place. And this is something that really in these times, you know, we live in times of confusion, because nowadays it's not just the lay person who's involved in these kind of things and backbiting and slandering people, but even people who wear the cloak of religiosity and people who, you know, religious charlatans, people who come in the as if they're people who are religious, speaking ill of other people and backbiting and slandering, and you know, in the name of the religion. And Imam Al-Ghazali has something very interesting to say about this in his Ihya. He says, nothing really gets you, nothing really produces a huge amount of following as much as controversy and cursing and insulting and degrading people. That's the easiest way to gain people's attention and for people to kind of listen to you. People love controversy, unfortunately. That's just how it is. But the thing is, this kind of seeking of attention is something in which it's only short-lived. And people truly will never be able, people truly will regret every moment they've spoken ill about somebody. Okay, even if you feel that that was something which was justified, even if you believe that that's something which was religiously sanctioned, in fact, it's something that a person should abstain from. If it's somebody who Allah has given a position of authority, in which if they were to say something, then it would be something which would have an impact. Or if somebody were to say something, it would mean that thing would show an effect, then it might be a different story. But even then, many of the scholars would still abstain, simply because of the fact that getting yourself involved in something which has even a small level or even a small amount of doubt is better to, according to the practice of many of the early scholars, they would still avoid it. Because nobody wants that on their back on the Day of Judgment. Nobody wants to answer for, you worked for all of those good deeds, you really want to just give it away just like that for free to somebody who hasn't done it simply because you spoke ill of them? It's not really worth it. So protect, safeguard your tongue from people's honor. Leave the people alone. Just leave people alone. Mind your own business. That's what people should be doing. Dawzi says, وَحَاسِبْ نَفْسَكَ فِي كُلِّ خَطْرَ, and take yourselves to account for every moment. So khatra, usually that's like the blinking of an eye. Every single moment in your life, take yourselves to account. You don't know what situation you'll be on the Day of Judgment when you are held accountable for the deeds that you've done. So always check yourself all the time. And that's something which is very important, because if you check yourself and you hold yourselves to account, then the less likelihood of you doing something which is questionable and something which is impermissible, because you're always checking yourself. You're always checking and making sure that you're, you know, that's what you call self-regulation. You're regulating yourself all the time so that you don't do something which is impermissible and something which is questionable. And that in of in itself is a type of accountability that lessens the accountability of the hereafter. And that's something which was alluded to in a statement by Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu that the author he quotes. He mentions firstly, he says, وَرَاقِبِ اللَّهَ فِي كُلِّ نَفَسِ, always be aware of Allah, and do muraqaba. Muraqaba means you are always in the zone of something. So you have muraqaba, you are overseeing. So always oversee your responsibility to Allah every moment and every breath that you take. That's what he says, وَرَاقِبِ اللَّهَ فِي كُلِّ نَفَسٍ. And then he quotes Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. He says, قَالَ عُمَرُ رَضِيَ anhu, حَاسِبُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ قَبْلَ أَن تُحَاسَبُوا وَزِنُوهَا قَبْلَ أَن تُزَنُوا. Which means, take yourselves to account before you are taken to account. Take yourselves to account before you are taken to account. وَزِنُوهَا قَبْلَ أَن تُزَنُوا. And weigh yourselves before you are weighed. Because on the day of judgment, there is accountability. So account, take yourselves to account before the day of accountability. And weigh yourselves, because that day your deeds will be weighed. Weigh yourselves before you are weighed. And that's something which is very heavy. And then he says, وَتَزَيَّنُوا. He said, وَتَزَيَّنُوا لِلْعَرْضِ الْأَكْبَرِ. And prepare yourselves on the day, meaning الْعَرْضِ الْأَكْبَرِ, on the day in which, on the great plain, everybody will be present in the day of judgment. يَوْمَ لَا تَخْفَى مِنْكُمْ خَافِيَةً. On a day in which nothing will be hidden from you. So you will have nothing to hide on that day. Everything will be exposed. So on a day in which every single thing will be exposed, and even the geography of the and the landscape in which the resurrection will be taking a place will be one plane in which everything can be exposed, then make sure that you prepare for that day by taking yourselves to account first and foremost, and weighing yourselves and weighing your actions. Something that I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the tawfiq to do. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable all of us to do good deeds. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the best reckoning on the day of judgment. Ameen. Jazakumullah khair for joining me this evening. Barakallahu feekum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.